Okay, good morning to one and all present here. So welcome to this Python class. Today I'll be discussing about NumPy, which is a very powerful tool as far as creating arrays, multi-dimensional arrays, and set of operations that are possible with arrays are concerned. So what I suggest for this particular topic is that if you can practice along with my explanation on your system, it would be better, so that if you can practice, you can understand better, right? So today's topic is NumPy. So what is NumPy? NumPy is a general purpose array processing package. It provides a high performance multi-dimensional array object and tools for working with these arrays. So few of you might be knowing that earlier days when artificial intelligence and even to the extent of digital image processing or the research that is taken place in image processing area, people used to use MATLAB as a tool for matrix operations. Now the same set of operations that are available with MATLAB is also available in Python. So it is a good news for computer science or information science programmers that they are not very much happy with the way MATLAB is being used for all those requirements. Now you can have some kind of programming. You can show your programming skills using these packages that are available or modules that are available in Python. It is a fundamental package for scientific computing with Python. It contains various features including the one which are listed, like a powerful n-dimensional array object. And this n-dimensional array can be used for processing the data which is obtained from real-time applications like weather forecasting or your share market analysis and so on. Sophisticated broadcasting functions that are available in real-time. Tools for integrating C++ and Fortran code. Why this is more important is because the presently available applications are basically implemented using the old programming languages like C++ and mathematical programming language called as Fortran, and most of those applications are being used effectively in scientific computing, and those cannot be easily replaced. So there must be some way by which we can connect those applications that are available, directly available or readily available in the system with the new system that are being implemented to provide more effective output or processing. So that is what is done using NumPy. Useful linear algebra, Fourier transformation and random number capabilities are also implemented in NumPy package. So besides the obvious scientific uses that we have seen till now, NumPy can also be used as an effective multi-dimensional container or generate data. Arbitrary data type can also be created at runtime. NumPy, which allows NumPy to seamlessly and speedily integrate with a wide variety of databases. So you can connect your Python application using NumPy to the database that is available, and you can process the data in a more better way or in the faster way. So as far as installation is concerned, because few of you might not be having the package that are required for running this Python on your system, so this particular package can be installed on Mac or Linux systems using a pip command called pip install NumPy. This if your system is connected to the network, automatically all the dependencies will be identified and it will download all the required packages, and then it will install the required software. Similarly, for Windows, though this pip command will not be available, you have already similar kind of pre-built-in Windows installer is available, which can be downloaded from this particular site that is already mentioned here. So using this particular, you can make a note of this, using this particular URL, you can always download the pre-installed or pre-built Windows installer for RamPy. So you need to find out what system configuration you have, whether you have got system 32-bit system, 64-bit system, 32-bit operating system, 64-bit operating system. You need to select the correct version of Python and then install it on your system manually. So first and foremost important availability or the objects that are created in Python is nothing but an array. You know already what is an array. What is an array? Array is a collection of similar type of elements, that is also called as array is a collection of homogeneous elements. So your NumPy will help you to create an object which holds the homogeneous elements stored in multidimensional way using an array. So basically it is a table of elements, and most of the times these tables will contain numbers. Sometimes these tables may contain even information other than numbers, like it can contain image or any other data depending on the requirement. But all the elements that are stored in such type of array are of similar type, and they are indexed by positive integers. You can relate this particular concept with the arrays that you have studied in C, C++ or any other language like Java, C#, so on and so forth. In the NumPy, this is very important. In NumPy, dimensions are called as axes. The number of axes is the rank of a particular array, that you need to understand. Now we will be numbering the axes, or we will be numbering the dimensions. All these days we used to call it as first dimension, second dimension, third dimension, two dimensional array, three dimensional array, n dimensional array, like that. Even in Python we have multi-dimensional arrays, and all these multi-dimensions will be numbered with axes. NumPy's array class is called as nd array class, right? This is called as nd array, that is n dimension array class, where n can be 1. If it is a 1, then it is a single dimension array, then it's a simple array. It is also known by the alias array, that you should be knowing, because sometimes it is asked like, what is difference between nd array and array in NumPy? Then you should be able to justify or explain both are same. So nd array is also having a nickname, you can say alias or a name, alternate name that is available, that is called as array. This is one example for you to understand what is an array, what is a nd array, or what is a two dimensional array, how two dimensional array is shown in Python, and what is a rank of such type of array, two dimensional array, and what are the axes, and all the important related attributes pertaining to a particular array. So this is your two dimensional array. We have two rows and three columns here, and columns will be termed as axis 0, rows will be termed as axis 1, remember. So rank of this particular two dimensional array is 2, as it has two dimensions or it has two axes. So rank of this will be 2. So what is the rank of a particular array, an nd array? It is the maximum axis number of a particular array. First dimension axis is length 2, second dimension axis is length 3. Overall shape can be expressed as 2, 3. So there are two rows and three columns in this array that is being shown here. So shape of the array is shown in the form of kind of a tuple, wherein first you are mentioning number of rows and then you are mentioning number of columns. So this is just an illustration, one simple program, or you can say a set of statements to help you to execute a program. We'll see each statement one by one. What I suggest is you open the Python editor or a Python compiler, any other compiler like Python IDLE or Jupyter or Spider. whichever is available to your disposal, and try to type these statements and see how it works. So first one is import numpy as numpy. So numpy, sometimes also called as numpy, as np. So np here is a short name given to numpy for the executions that we'll be doing. So whenever you want to call an array constructor, now you understand or you have already studied what is class, what is object, how to call a constructor, all that. So now you should be able to appreciate how this particular call is happening. So here you can see this particular object is getting created by calling np.array, right, this constructor. For that I am passing, what is this? Any idea what is it? While studying lists, you have already studied that this is list of lists. You have got two lists within a single list. So this is list of lists. Now this list of lists is converted to an array, which is a two-dimensional array. Then when I say print array of type, type of the array will be displayed. So we'll see what is the type of the array. You will understand what is the type of the array. For every data type in Python, though you are not concerned with the type while declaring a variable, internally every object has been defined with a type. Like for example, if you are creating a variable of integer type, then the type of that object will be int 32, right? Similarly, if it is floating point, then the type of that particular object is float. Though you are not specifying the type of that particular object whenever you are creating the object, but whenever the object is created by the Python, automatically the type will be mentioned by the compiler. Okay, that is the reason why we are trying to find out what is the type of this particular object that we have created just now. So whenever you pass the object of interest to type function, you will get the type of that particular object at runtime. This plays a very important role, because sometimes it may so happen that at a particular point of time while executing a program or while writing a program which is very huge, you know the name of the variable, you want to fire some functions or you want to call some functions using that particular object, but you don't know what that type, what is the type of that object is. Depending on the type of the object, the available functions will differ, isn't it? So first we'll have to find out what is the type of that particular object. Then print array dimensions. Okay, so to print array dimensions, you will have to use the function, or you will have to use this particular property of this particular object. So this is a member, arr.ndim. dim stands for dimension, n stands for n dimensions. Okay, so it will display the dimensions, what is the dimension of the array. Then printing shape of the array will get you the total number of rows and columns in the form of tuple. Printing the size of total number of elements of an array, it will display how many total number of elements are there in the given two dimensional array or n dimensional array. So it will count eventually each element as a single element. In the first row we have got 3, in the second row we have got 3, total number of elements is 6 that will be displayed on the screen. Print type of element in an array. So if you want to see what is the type of each and every element that is stored in the array, then you will have to use arr.dtype. You will have to understand properly, if you use type and the object for this is arr, then you will get the type of this particular object, and when you use arr.dtype, then you will get the data type of the element that is stored in a particular array. This concept is very important. So this is the output that you get. Okay, so what is the type of the array? Type of array, the array that is created is numtype nd array type. Okay, it is numpy's nd array type. It is array, it is created using a constructor of class numpy dot nd array. Number of dimensions for the array that we have created is 2. It is a two-dimensional array, because there are rows and columns. Then you want to see the shape, then if you specify the shape of the array, then it will display in the form of tuple how many rows are there and how many columns are there. Then the number of elements in the array is displayed as size of the array is totally there are 6 because it is containing 6 elements. So 2 cross 3 is 6 elements. Array stores elements of a type. What is the type of each and every element that is stored in the array? It is int 64 type. So this is what is shown in the previous slide. So if you make a small change in place of this, in place of 1, 2, 3, anywhere, somewhere, if you change one of the element to floating point like this, if you make this as 1.0 or 2.0, then all the elements will be of floating point, and here type that will be displayed will be floating point. That you can try. So you can make a note of these things and try these things on the compiler or IDE that we have for Python. So these are the basics of NumPy array that you need to understand, because these will help you for performing various basic and complicated operations on array. So this is the output. So far we have just created a simple two-dimensional array. Then we have found different attributes of the array, like what is the type of the array, what is the dimension of the array, what is how to find the shape of the array, how to find the total number of elements stored in the array, then how to find the type of each and every element that is stored in the array. So even if you make one small change or one change in one of the elements of the array, all the elements will be considered of a same type, because array is collection of similar type of elements. So now we'll see array creation by using different ways. There are many ways to create arrays in NumPy. There are various ways to create arrays in NumPy. For example, you can create array from a regular Python list, because most of the times people are very much used to writing programs using lists, because there are so many inbuilt operations that are possible with the list. List.tuple using the array function. The type of the a resulting array is decided from the type of elements in the sequence. So elements types are usually unknown, but the size is known, because the number of elements that you are passing to array while creating using list or tuple is always known. NumPy offers several functions to create arrays with initial placeholder contents. Like you can create array of zeros. You can have 100 cross 100 array that which contains hundreds of elements. Like you might have heard about sparse matrix in your data structure subject, where you have got more number of zeros in a two-dimensional array, and there are very minimum number of non-zero elements, right? If you want to create sparse matrix, if you want to work with sparse matrix, it is very useful. Then even you can have a multi-dimensional array which contains all ones, right? You can create an empty array, so on and so forth. That is possible using arrays. So if suppose you want to create, if the requirement is like you want to create an array which contains sequence of values, like you want to have an array which is containing values from 55 to 155, okay, sequence of values. then it is possible. You can use NumPy built-in functions to do that. You can use step size to specify the jump between two values that are created. You can have line space, that is lin space, which returns the spaced values within a given interval. You can reshape the array that is already created. You can suppose if you have three cross two array, like there are six elements, or you have got say a three cross two array which is having six elements, and later on you want to resize it as one cross six element. So that is possible. You can do that. I mean, provided the number of elements do not change, you can always resize it. Okay. Then you can flatter the array like what I have told just now. Like if you have got say array which is n dimensional and you want to create a single, out of using that you want to create a single dimensional array, there is a direct function available. If you want to create say array which have two dimensional array which has got 12 elements, right, 6 cross 2, 12 elements, later on you want to change it to 4 cross 3, that is also possible by using resize function. This is an example. So what we are doing here is, first thing is we download or we import NumPy package. Then using the list we are creating an array and we are storing it in array object A. So what is to be noted here in this particular example is that we are specifying a list as the first parameter. The second parameter is very important. Though the list contains all the values or elements or of integer, second data type is floating point. So elements that are stored in the list are of type floating point. So using this array that is created using the array function in NumPy, you can see how the elements are created. I will show you the output in the next slide. So you can make a note that using np.array function, what we are doing is we are passing list as the first parameter, which is list of lists, to create two dimensional array. Then we are specifying the data type. Data type we are specifying it as a floating point, right? So the values that are stored in the list are integer, right? But the data type that is considered for storing these values will be floating point. That is very important, that you need to understand. So now you can see, because of the print function that was written after creating an array, we are able to display the contents of the array, and you can make a note that all the elements that are stored in the array are of floating point. So it is actually 1.0, 2.0, 4.0, 5.0, 8.0 and 7.0. So all the values which we have specified as integer 1, 2, 4, 5, 8, 7 have been stored as floating point. Okay, make a note of this. And then you can execute and see whether you are able to get the two dimensional array which contains floating point elements. So now, as we have seen in the previous example, that we have passed a list and we have created an array. Now we are passing a tuple to create an array. So anything that you want to pass, you will have to pass it within the pair of round brackets or within the pair of brackets. So here this is a tuple, from here to here it ranges. So this is a tuple that we are passing as a parameter to array function, array constructor, to construct an array called as B. So that is a tuple because it is enclosed in round brackets. That is stored in B. Then we are creating another array of 3 cross 4 size and all are set to 0. So using zeros function of particular np, that is NumPy package, using zeros function we are creating 3 cross 4 matrix and all values will be set to 0. Now if you display using print statement, you can see the contents like this. So first array, though we have used tuple there, in the output you can see it is being shown, means appearance is like a list, it is not a list, it is an array, remember. It's not a list, the tuple is not converted to list, it is converted to an array. Similarly, a multi-dimensional array is created, which is of a size, what is the size? 3 cross 4, and all the values of that particular 3 cross 4 array are set to 0. So this is the output of these two statements. Okay. So this is to create a complex number arrays, right, which is of 3 cross 3 size. Here type of the value that we are storing, the data type of the value, you can see complex, this you have not, this type was not available in earlier programming languages, you can make a note. Then we have got another function called as random.random, right, this is to create array of random values. Now you can see an array initialized with all 6's, array type is complex. Since array type is complex, it is stored as a complex number array. Then we have got a random array which will be created using random numbers between 0 to 1. Right? So random number array is generated between 0 to 1, and the size of the array is 2 cross 2. So if you want to have an array which contains a range of values between 0 to 30 with a step of, you don't know how many elements that array will contain because you don't have exactly, means you might have not calculated. This is a small number, 0 to 30, you can easily identify how many elements will be there. But if suppose you want to have a huge array which is having values between two numbers, that is range of values, and with a step value, you can use arrange function. So this will get you the array which is having the numbers between 0 to 30, right, with a step sequence of 5, with the steps of 5, and the next one is with a step size of 10. So these two will create an array with a step size what is difference between the first one and the second one is that in the first one we have got a range 0 to 30 and the steps of 5, and the second one we have got line space. It is not arrange function, remember, this is not arrange function, it is lin space function. In lin space function we are specifying the range of values to be considered between 0 to 5, right, with the 10 values to be created. So this particular array will contain 10 values which range between 0 to 5, right? So you can see we have got the array, first array, which contains values between 0 to 30, right, and step size is 5. And most important thing that is to be remembered, you people already know that the last value is not included. 30 is not included, though 30 comes after 25 in the step of 5. So 30 is excluded from the list. Right? So 0, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, like this. If suppose you want to have a table of 5, you want to have a table of 5. with the array, then what input is to be given for this? If you want to have a table of 5, then you can write 0. You don't want to have 0 because 0 is not there in the table of 5. Then you want to start with 5, isn't it? So from 5 to 55, because you want to include 50, right? np dot arrange, it will be like this. It is a range, it better pronounce it as a range, otherwise you end up writing arrange. It is not arrange, it is a range. Table of 5 is equal to np dot a range. The first value I want to have it as 5, and it should end as 55, and step size is 5. This should get you. What should it get you? It should get you a table of 5 into TBL 5 array. So TBL 5 array will contain 5's table. And this is another one which line space or lin space function, which is used to create 10 values between the range 0 to 5. So these are the values that are generated by the system itself. You are not able to generate, you cannot specify what is the size. So this is about creating array sequence or sequence of numbers in an array. Now let us look at few more examples related to reshaping. So what do we have? We have 3 cross 4 array, right? 3 cross 4 array which contains 3 rows and 4 columns. So totally how many elements are there? 12 elements are totally. 12 elements are there in a given array called as ARR. We want to reshape that array into 3 dimensional array, which is 2 cross 2 cross 3. You can see that the total number of elements in 2 cross 2 cross 3 is also same as 3 cross 4. That is, in both the cases the number of elements will be 12 only. So this is the requirement. Using reshape function, now you are creating a 3 dimensional array which will be having the values like 1 2 3 4 5 2 4 2 1 2 0 1 only, but arranged in 2 cross 2 cross 3 manner. So once you do this, you can see the new reshaped array is available in new array, and you can identify how it changes. We are displaying both original array as well as new array. This is the original array. Original array is 1 2 3 4 5 2 4 2 1 2 0 1. Then in the reshaped array we have two cross three arrays. How many arrays we have? This is 1 2 cross three array. This is another 2 cross three array, and the elements are managed using the array that we have. So first three values will be initialized to first three values of the first two dimensional array. The next three values 4 5 2 will be initialized here, and similarly 4 2 1 will be initialized here, and 201 will be initialized here. So total all elements that are available in the original array are reshaped and stored in the another array. This is a important concept, that how to reshape the existing array into the new array that is required with the specific requirement. That means by having even a list of values, you have thousands of list of values and you want to convert that to a matrix, that is possible. Using reshape, you can convert a list of values or tuple of values or even the values that are stored in the file, which can be imported or brought into a list or the tuple, then that tuple or the list can be used for creating an array of one dimension or multiple dimensions. So you will have to do some kind of playing with the order of the matrix, and you will get n-dimensional array as per your requirements. Then where these n-dimensional arrays are basically used, these are basically used in real-time applications like artificial intelligence, right? Even image processing, there are multiple frame of images being stored and you want to process all those frames, then you need to have such complicated arrays. So this is the reverse thing that we have done till now. This is about, like, you have an array which is two dimensional, you want to flatten that into a single dimension, that is done using flatten function. So you have created an array which is two dimensional array, then you flatten the array, and that is available in FLARR. Flatten array is available here. This is your original array and this is the flatten array. You can see here you have got a two dimensional array with six elements. You have got a single dimension array which contains six elements as a single dimension, like a simple array. So how it is done? Make a note of this. We have got a two dimensional array stored in ARR. Then we use that array to call function called as FLATTEN, which is flatten function, that is available in array class, to get the flatten array, and that will return an array that is stored in FLARR object, and then that is used for displaying the contents. This is the output. So till now what we have done is we have just seen how the array works, we have seen the attributes of the array, we have seen how to create the array, right? Then we have seen how to reshape the array, then we have seen how to flatten the array, how to get multi-dimensional array from a single dimension, okay? How to create an array with pre-filled values like zeros, ones, so on and so forth. So these are the pretty basic operations that are available with array creation, right? Once you create the array, you have got set of functions which can be performed on a particular array, right? That will be discussed in the next slides. So here in this slide, we will be discussing about indexing the array contents. Like, you have stored the array, you have created the array, you have stored the values, everything is all arrays and everything is populated properly. Unless and until you are able to access the contents of the array, then whatever array you have created is of no use. So to make use of the array that is created, we will use array indexing. For array indexing is basically done in many ways. First one is slicing, second one is integer array indexing, and the third one is Boolean array indexing. All the three types of slicing or indexing, or rather indexing of arrays, is very interesting, right? So these basics are important because sometimes your requirements are such that you want to access only the part of the array, not the entire array. Then you need to slice the array, access only the part of the array, perform certain operations on that, and then restore the operations, like what you do in artificial intelligence, something called as, just remember this, once you start studying artificial intelligence and data science and other things, you can remember this, like there is something called as convolution. The two matrices are being convoluted, right? In such cases, we want a part of the matrix to be performing an operation with another small matrix. That is called as convolution operation. For such requirements, we require slicing, indexing, and Boolean indexing, and so on and so forth. So let us look at each one of these in detail. First one is slicing. Just like lists in Python, you have already done slicing with lists, slicing with strings. So slicing operation that you have done with lists and strings same set of operations can be performed with the arrays as well. So slicing, just like lists in Python, NumPy arrays can also be sliced. As arrays can be multidimensional, you need to specify the slice for each dimension of the array. This is very important because the object that you have used so far, like the list or a string, you have considered it as a, you can consider now it as a single dimension array. There is a single dimension because the elements are stored one after the other. There the slicing is very simple, but if you want to slice the array, then you will have to slice it row wise or column wise depending on your requirement. So you need to specify the slicing values for multiple dimensions that are being considered in array. Then you have got integer array indexing. In this method, lists are passed for indexing for each dimension. One-to-one mapping of corresponding element is done to construct a new arbitrary array. So you are specifying integer values for indexing, and then you are extracting those values from particular row or a column. Then Boolean array indexing. In this method, we use some kind of a function or a condition to extract a certain set of values that are stored in an array. If the value satisfies a particular condition, then we extract that value and then we consider that value for further processing. So Boolean array indexing is a very interesting one, wherein each and every element will be checked against a condition for satisfaction. If that particular element satisfies a particular condition, then that element is further considered for processing. So again, you can see what is this particular program is doing. Is first and foremost important statement is import NumPy as np. Always remember that this statement is to be written properly or without fail. If you forget to write this, then you cannot create array. You will get a trace error for that particular statement. So how it is written is np.array, then you specify a list which is passed as a parameter to this particular function, and then this function creates an array, right? What type of array is created in this? What is the rank of the array? What is the size of the array? What is the dimension of the array? All these things you should know. What is the rank now? Okay, you need to identify, you just find out those basic functions. You fire those basic functions and find out what is the rank of this particular array, right? What is the dimension, what is the shape, all that, okay? Now, since there are few elements which are integer type and few elements which are floating point, but internally all the elements will be stored as floating point. So, considering this as an input array, okay, remember this. This you will have to make a note that this particular array, two-dimensional array which is 4 cross 4, okay, which is the dimension of this particular 2D array, will be considered as an input array for all the functions that we'll be studying henceforth in the next slides to come. So slicing an array is shown here. What this particular thing does is array with first two rows and alternate columns 0 and 2, right? Print it. This will print array with first two rows and alternate columns 0 and 2. Okay, you can see first two rows, alternate columns 0 and 2. These are the first two rows, this one and this one. Alternate columns, this is the value considered minus 1, 0, 4, and 6. Okay, alternate columns. So you can see minus 1, minus 1.0, 0.0, 4.0, and 6.0. That is mentioned using this syntax. This is a slicing that takes place. So for to understand this thoroughly, what you should do is you will have to consider slicing that has been explained for lists. Okay, in the lists also we have done this, wherein we are specifying this as a step size, and this is number of rows, first two rows, right? This is a slicing factor, and this is the step factor used for slicing. And then we are not specifying the start and end, so it will be considered as beginning as 0, end as the last column, that is 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. But since it considers 0, then it will skip 1, then it will consider 2, it will not consider 3, okay, then it ends. So that is the reason why it is showing the output as minus 1, 0, 4, 6, which are the elements in the first two rows at 0th column and second column. Okay, this is about slicing the array. This is for integer array indexing example. This is a bit different when compared to slicing. You can see how it works. Again, we are considering the same array. I have purposely shown the array once again for you to avoid the confusion. So integer array indexing goes like this. If suppose you are writing array, don't get confused with this syntax, as we are creating an array of this type. This is not array, this is just ARR. ARR is the array object that's already created using np.array, right? So np.array object ARR is being sliced or indexed using integer array indexing, right? So for this we specify two lists. First list contains the first set of values and the second list contains second set of values. Then you can see how those values are getting sliced. So what we are getting here is the combination of first value available in list 1 and first value available in list 2. That is, this is row number and this is column number, this is row number and this is column number, so on and so forth. So we have got the first value, which is 0, 3, 1, 2, 2, 1 and 3, 0 available in temp array. So what we have here is values 4, 6, 0 and 3, and the values available are with the index values 0, 3, 1, 2, 2, 1, 3, 0. Now you can relate these things with mapping of the values available in two sub lists of the list here. Okay, so you can see that the first value 4.0 is obtained from 0, 3. Okay, you need to find out how the values are being done. So this is being obtained. So this is row 0, third column, this is value 4, this is 0, 3. Then row 1, column 2, this is row 1, column 2 is 6. Then we have got row 2, column 1, this is row 2, column 1 is 0, right? Then we have got row 3, column 0, this is row 3, column 0, which is 3. But the thing that is to be observed is that all the elements that are stored in this particular array are of floating point type, and the indexes that are specified in two sublists of this particular list are mapped for row and column. Okay, for proper understanding, these things are written in print statement. These are written in print statement to have proper mapping. Okay. Hope this is clear to you. So this is for elements greater than 0. The output is shown on the top, but just to have a proper visibility, that has been enlarged and shown here. So condition here is the array elements available in array called ARR, which are greater than 0. This is the condition. This is the Boolean condition, right? And then this particular array is a Boolean array. Okay, if array value is greater than 0, then it will contain 1, otherwise it will contain 0. Then you are using that array for as a parameter for this, or as a condition parameter for this array to get the value. So for all these values that are being displayed here are greater than 0. Now again, this is for this particular array. So these elements have been removed. So if these values are less than 0, minus 1 is excluded, 0 is excluded, minus 0.5 is excluded, this 0 is excluded, this 0 is excluded, this minus 7 is excluded, and only the remaining values are available here. So remaining values are available here. So all the values that are less than 0 are not available. If you want to include 0, then you can change the condition as array greater than or equal to 0. You will get all the elements that are greater than or equal to 0. Depending on the condition, the array is prepared, and that array is then further used for indexing purpose. So this is, I hope this is clear to you. So if you want to extract only the values from a particular sparse matrix, as which I have already told you, the sparse matrix is the one which contains more number of zero elements. And if you want to get only those values which are non-zero, then you can write a condition like, if the ARR is greater than zero, if suppose the name of the matrix is mat, if suppose, if the mat element is greater than zero, then store that into a condition array. Then use that condition array to extract the values from the array to get the values from the sparse matrix, and process the values and store them back into the matrix. So the basic operations that can be performed on the array using NumPy package are these. There are n number of, there are multiple or plethora of built-in arithmetic functions are provided in NumPy. The operation on single array, we can use overloaded arithmetic operators. You know what is overloading an operator. You have already studied in Java and C++ that if you want to provide for an existing operator, if you want to provide a new operation, that is called as operator overloading. To do element wise operations on array, to create a new array in case of plus equal to, minus equal to, star equal to, these are shorthand operators which you have already studied when you have studied operators. The existing array can be modified. Like, you can use shorthand operators as you were using with the simple variables, you can use shorthand operators with the arrays also. And if you do that, then the basic set of operations will be performed, like adding two arrays or adding a value to an array, subtracting a particular value from the entire array, or multiplying each and every element of the array with the value. All these set of operations are possible. This is an example you can just have a note of. Like, again, we have written import numpy as np. I will go through each and every line for better clarification. Then we need to import numpy package. Then create an array. Now the array is single dimension array, np dot array 1, 2, 5, 3. What is the order of this array? The order of this matrix, you can say, it is 1 cross 4. Add 1 to every element. How to add 1 to every element? You can just write a plus 1. Adding 1 to every element, you will get 1 added to every element. So you get the output as 2, 3, 6, 4. Isn't it? So that you can see here, you have got 2, 3, 6, 4 for the second one. This one is obtained from adding 1 to the each and every element of the array. Subtracting 3 from each element. If you have to subtract 3 from each element, then you can write a minus 3. So 1 minus 3, 2 minus 3, 5 minus 3, and 3 minus 3. 1 minus 3 is minus 2. 2 minus 3 is minus 1, 5 minus 3 is 2, and 3 minus 3 is 0. That is obtained for the second one. So this is minus 2, minus 1, 2, 0. This is the result of minus 3, array minus 3. Then multiply each element by 10. So if you want to multiply each element by 10, then you can write a multiplied by 10. And then you can get the value that is getting multiplied by 10. So 1 cross 10, 2 cross 10, 5 cross 10, 3 cross 10. So you get 10, 20, 50, 30 in the resulting array. Okay, so this is the resulting array that is available. Then if you want to square the elements, then you can use double asterisk or double star, right? You can see how simple it is to get the values from the array that is already populated. Now you get another array, or this is a temporary array that is being stored, which is of power 2. Then 1 cross 1 power 2 is 1, 2 power 2 is 4, 5 power 2 is 25, 3 power 2 is 9. That is obtained here. You can see for 1, 2, 5, 3, corresponding elements are 1, 4, 25 and 9. Even you can double the value. For doubling the value, you can use A star equal to 2. This is to modify the existing array. In the rest of the examples that we have seen till now, the array will not get changed because the operation is done with each and every element, and temporary array that is resulting from the operation is being displayed on the screen. But wherein, in this example, we are modifying an existing array by multiplying each and every element with 2. So now we are doubling the value of each and every element in the 2 element by 2. So when you display the contents of the array, the doubled value is getting displayed. 1 is displayed as 2, 2 is displayed as 4, 5 is displayed as 10, and 3 is displayed as 6. Means those are doubled values. Original value was 1, 2, 5, and 3. So now you have used these particular set of operations, you people are familiar with basic operations now. Now the little bit complicated operations that are required in mathematical applications are like finding the transpose of a matrix, inverse of a matrix, all those things, rank of a matrix, all those things need to be understood properly. So the basic one that is available here is being demonstrated in the set of statements that are shown in this particular slide, is to find out the transpose of the matrix. So this is the matrix. What is the order of the matrix now? It is 3 rows, 3 columns. The original matrix I am displaying, then the transpose of the matrix can be obtained by A dot capital T. If you just write A dot capital T, you will get the transpose of the matrix. Okay. So this is